No? Okay. Not to his knowledge. But anyway, he comes to us, and we have his wife over in the gymnasium speaking, and he will be speaking here today for lesson and for the class. Brian Collins.
Well, good morning. It's good to see everybody here this morning. I appreciate you coming out and being in Bible class, but to come out and be in this class for sure. It's a pleasure for me to be with you. As he mentioned, we've been living in Huntsville now for about 8 years. This is my eighth year, but we always love to come south. If you have a Bible with you this morning, we're going to be in Philippians, the fourth chapter, is where we're going to take our lesson this morning. Philippians chapter 4. I know that this is a chapter that you're well familiar with. Of course, the book of Philippians itself is considered to be a letter of joy. And here in chapter 4, the kind of joy that the apostle is talking about is, I really believe, at least in the first 9 verses that we'll be talking about this morning, is really the joy of peace. Because, I mean, of all the things you've ever wanted in your life, I would say, I'll go ahead and guess that peace is the one thing that you've probably always wanted more than anything. I think that most people would give almost anything they've made, earned, you know, developed, built in their life just to have peace in their lives. So we'll read Romans chapter 4, the first 9 verses in just a moment. But I want to kind of set that up because, you know, it's one thing for us to read it as modern readers. We need to understand the people that originally read this letter, received this letter from the hand of Paul, and what their understanding was. You've probably, if you remember your history courses, you probably remember a term called Pax Romana. That's the Latin term for the official doctrine of the Roman Empire. And of course, this was first century, so this was, I would say, mid-antiquity, and so this was sort of in the middle of the Roman Empire. It was an 800-year empire, and they're somewhere maybe close to the middle here. But the official doctrine was Roman peace. That's how you translated that Latin term, Pax Romana. But Rome's version of peace was, if you know anything about the Roman Empire, it was an enforced sort of peace. It was enforced at the tip of a spear. They insisted on peace, and they sought peace through strength. You've heard that term before. But one of the beautiful things that even an enforced kind of peace did was it made it possible for the spread of the gospel. Matter of fact, I believe, and scholars believe, that in Galatians chapter 4, verse 4, when Paul wrote about the fullness of time, that's what he was talking about, that there was this empire-wide Roman doctrine of peace, Pax Romana, but they had also built roads where you could get from Jerusalem and other parts east all the way into Rome. That's how we get that term that we still use, all roads lead to Rome, right? Because they literally did. But as I said a minute ago, Rome's version of peace was an enforced sort of peace. They were going to have peace. They insisted on peace. And so you think about the original people that would have read this letter the very first time in the city of Philippi, at the church in Philippi. And let me say that thinking about Philippi and Paul starting the congregation there, Acts chapter 16, he met a lady, Lydia. They were, you know, when Paul was on his missionary journeys, when he would meet with the saints, it was usually he would, well, not necessarily when he met with the saints, but when he would go to a new city, what did he do? He went to the synagogue first thing. But you notice that in Philippi, there was no synagogue, all right? And so the saints weren't meeting in the synagogue. They were meeting on a riverbank, right? And what that tells you is that, of course, we know that this was in Europe. This was, you know, the first mission that reached over into continental Europe. But that tells us that there were not enough Jewish males there for there to be a synagogue. They were the ladies there, because there weren't very many males, there were a lot of people meeting down by the river, and that's where Paul met them and came across Lydia, where he converted her later. But the people of Philippi, This would have been a Roman outpost. It would have been a militaristic sort of town. I am originally from Hopkinsville, Kentucky. And Hopkinsville, Kentucky is right next door to Fort Campbell, Kentucky. If you go over into Clarksville, you go over into Oak Grove, Clarksville, Tennessee, Oak Grove, Kentucky, and Hopkinsville to a lesser extent, you start to learn what it is to be in a military town. Of course, I'm in Huntsville. Fort Campbell is, you see a lot of enlisted people, okay? In Huntsville, which is also a military town, it's a lot of your upper command echelon. So a little different sort of culture. But here in Philippi, the Christians who are reading this letter, peace in their minds would have signified something very different, I think. And by writing this letter, a letter of joy and the joy of peace, I think that Paul is allowing, is trying to expand their minds. He's trying to put in their minds something better, that there is a better alternative peace than what Rome can provide. So let's look at chapter 4. If you've got your Bibles open, there in verse 1 he says, "Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm thus in the Lord, my beloved. I entreat Euodia and I entreat Syntyche to agree in the Lord. Yes, I ask also, true companion, help these women who have labored side by side with me in the gospel, together with Clement and the rest of my fellow workers whose names are in the book of life. Rejoice in the Lord always. Again, I will say rejoice." Now we're getting to the part of this passage that you're very familiar with. "Let your reasonableness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God, and the peace of God, which surpasses all understanding, will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus. Finally, brothers, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you." Now, there's a lot there to unpack, and we're going to spend the rest of our time today really unpacking this. Because, as I said a minute ago, living in a town with a militaristic sort of culture had some drawbacks, okay? So here's where we get to sort of where the rubber meets the road and why peace would have been sort of mind-expanding, you know, expanding their horizons. Philippi would not have been a place where you wanted your children walking the streets by themselves, okay? It wasn't that kind of peaceful place, right? In this context, you as an adult, as a father, you would have wanted to accompany your children. Not that you could have stopped anything, but it would have made you feel better. You wouldn't have wanted your son walking the streets alone to fetch water or anything, or to go to the market, because you or your son might, if you were not already a slave, you could have been pressed into service by any Roman soldier. Your son could have been pressed into service as an armor bearer, a sword bearer. There's any number of things that could have happened. You, if you weren't already a slave, could have been pressed into service or enslaved. And there are many other things that could have happened that we just won't even use our imaginations on. But there could have been really terrible things that could have happened besides being conscripted into the army against your will. But people... I say that because I'm trying to get in my mind, what would people have understood of peace? They would have understood Roman peace. Peace that was enforced at the tip of a spear. Peace through strength. Peace through intimidation. Because I think the people would have been intimidated to come up against the army in the field. So people would have had the sort of attitude that had been born out of harsh living conditions. So they probably... Certainly, a message of peace would have been a welcome message, but they would have had to parse through a lot of things. And Paul, I think, goes to great lengths to understand, help them understand what kind of peace he's talking about. I think that they would have had something much better to look forward to with Paul's letter, and that is that there was a peace, a sense of peace, that was far better than Rome could provide. And so as we dig a little deeper into the text, the first thing that I noticed that that stands out to me is the better sort of peace than Rome could offer was, the first thing is peace among the brethren, there in the very first three verses. It may come as sort of a shock, or not a shock, but when we read this passage about Euodia and Syntyche, what would that have to do with peace? What, you know, well, that's peace among the brethren. And I'll talk more about that in just a minute. That's kind of where I get this idea that part of that sense of peace was having peace among the brethren. And how good is it to have peace among the brethren today where we are? Like I said at the beginning, of all the things we want, of all the things that we pursue in life, probably the one thing that's more precious than any is the sense of peace that we have. We would give a lot of things. We would sacrifice a lot of things to make sure that our lives were filled with peace. I mentioned earlier that Paul started this congregation. So that being said, we read that in Acts chapter 16. He had a vested interest in this congregation, and he knows the people there personally, and he calls these two women out by name. Euodia and Syntyche. But he also calls this congregation his joy and crown, and is encouraging their steadfast faith. I think that's important from the standpoint that it would have been very difficult in that day and time to maintain a Christian lifestyle, because I think they would have found, at least in the early stages, they would have found Christianity to be strange. You've got to remember, this is a Roman colony. It's a militaristic town. It is a military outpost. And they were largely pagans. Okay? So, you know, I don't want to get into a long discussion about pagan culture, but how many Christians do you live around where you live today? You don't have to answer me. You don't have to raise your hand. If you want to say something, you can. I'm not the only one who has to talk today in this particular setting. How many Christians live around you? Well, you know, there may be people who attend other churches and call themselves Christians that live around you. You have some basis of understanding, but, and of course, I don't know what the traditions are around here, but you think about, well, I'll just tell you about where I live. I live in a neighborhood that's not very festive, okay? Some people decorate for Christmas, some don't. I really don't much, okay? I'm probably in a good neighborhood because I'm not very festive, okay? But there are some people, they decorate for all the holidays. Some people keep their lights up for a long time. But it's that sort of thing that I want to key in on when you're thinking about pagans. Pagans had all kinds of holidays in this day and time. And there were, you know, if you had gates or on your front door, there were charms that were nailed to the front door and to the gate. And if you didn't do that, if you didn't follow suit, then there was something wrong with you, okay? That's what I'm trying to get at, is for us to have an understanding of what it would have been like to live as a Christian in a pagan culture, because you would stand out like a sore thumb. But more than that, as a person that has heard the gospel the first time, and then it's time for them to learn about something like the Lord's Supper. How was the Lord's Supper described in the gospels? Jesus told the saints that unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, I'm not living in you. What do you think pagans would have thought about that? Well, the truth is that the ancient writings we have are that the pagans thought that this was really strange, that Christians eat flesh and drink blood. They thought of it very literal. Now, you and I, we think that's strange because we've grown up in a culture that has at least somewhat valued the Judeo-Christian ethic. And so we come along and we think about eating flesh and drinking blood. We realize that it's not literal because we've grown up in kind of a church cult type culture where those things aren't so strange. But it shouldn't be too far from our minds that if you live beside someone who has never been to a church, that's probably not where you want to start the conversation, is it, about Christianity? Okay? You may live close to somebody where it's going to be hard to start the conversation about Jesus because they don't believe in Jesus. Here living in the United States, they've probably heard of people talk about Jesus, but they get as far from it. And what I'm talking about is you may live close to someone, you may know somebody, you may work with somebody who is a Hindu. You have many Hindus around this area? What about Muslims? Do you live near any Muslims? Do you work with Muslims? Okay. Now, Muslims, they don't think that anything about Jesus is necessarily weird. They just don't believe in him as the Son of God. They believe that he's one of the prophets, but I can tell you from experience that this is the one prophet that you can't talk about in any Muslim country. Isn't that strange? You can go anywhere and you can talk about any prophet in Islam in an Islamic country, but Jesus is the one that you better not talk about. It's the one that they've got laws against talking about. Okay. Now that's a long explanation about where they would have been in their minds as far as trying to understand this peace, this joy that they could have in peace. Christianity would have, you know, to get them to the point where they would obey the gospel would have been a tough task, okay? But Paul did it, and they were his joy and his crown. But evidently, when we look at the names that are named there, Euodia and Syntyche, these two ladies, there's been a disagreement. There has been a division by these sisters, and he says, you know, these women need to be of one mind, and you need to help them come to be of one mind. And there are a lot of passages throughout the New Testament, I don't have time to name them all, that talk about all of us being of one mind. Being of one mind contributes to having peaceful relations between brethren. There is no trouble like church trouble, is there? So we want to have peace among the brethren. Now, the congregation was urged, you see there, to help these women come to terms with one another, to be of one mind. I think that it's also kind of instructive for us to look at this and realize that Paul assures them that their names are still in the book of life. In other words, this was not the kind of dispute that was going to risk their souls. Okay? And they were not disciplined by the church. It was of such a nature that he said, just help these women come together and be of one mind. Okay. So even disagreements among us that aren't really that serious, we need to be of one mind to have peace among the brethren. The other thing that I'll mention on this that would have been something that promoted peace in their lives is the fact that when they came out of that pagan world, when they became Christians, if they came out of paganism, you think about, let me put it in these terms. My parents obeyed the gospel when I was 2 years old. Okay. I don't remember it, okay, but they tell this story pretty often. I think I have a scar on my forehead somewhere where I fell as a child and hit one of the pews and had to have stitches. Okay, I have no memory of it. Probably a good thing, right? But I hear that story from them. And when they obeyed the gospel, because my dad worked with a Christian, they left the family religion. I always wondered why we were treated in my family as if we were black sheep. So I'm sure that some of you have had an experience like that. So you take that experience in our lifetime, becoming Christians, and what it's like to face some people who will ostracize you for changing your religion. Now we can talk about that a little deeper, but that's what it is in their minds, that you're changing your religion, right? Think about what it would have been like to go from being a pagan, believing in many gods, and being very superstitious, right? And I don't even want to get into what their superstitions would have been. To then go to this strange religion that talked about eating flesh and drinking blood and not celebrating all of these different festivals and holidays that they had in paganism to be these simple New Testament Christians, right? But what promoted peace was the fact that when you left and you may have unintentionally alienated people in your family, you had a new family. You weren't just given a new name. You had a new family. You had other brothers and sisters, new brothers and sisters. You remember that scene in the Gospels where Jesus is healing and preaching and teaching, and his mother and his brothers are looking for him. They're worried about him, and somebody in the crowd tells him, says, "Hey, your mother and your brothers are outside, and they're looking for you. They're worried. They can't find you." And he says, "You look around this room," and I'm paraphrasing here, "these are my mother and my brothers and my sisters." When you come to Christ, you have this peace in the brotherhood. You have a new family. You have people that you can come among and you can associate with out of fear. Without fear. I knew I said that. That didn't sound right. Without fear. You can come together with these people without fear. What other associations in the Roman Empire would they have had where they could do that, where they could fully trust people, where they could put their lives in these people's hands and know that they were going to live another day, and they could associate with people like this? See, I don't know that we value that as much as a church. The association that we have with brothers and sisters, that there are people that we... Now, I'm not saying that about you specifically, because I'm sure that you do have associations with at least some others. But yet I think that broadly speaking, I don't know that we treasure that or value that as much as we ought to. The fact that we have people that we can go to tomorrow that we can trust and we can talk to and we can lean upon and gain strength from. Second thing that I think he talks about in verses 4-9, the second kind of peace that is better than anything the Roman government can offer them is peace with God. Look at verse 4. "Rejoice in the Lord always." Again, I'll say, he says it twice, I will say rejoice. What did they have to rejoice in? What do we rejoice in? What do you rejoice in? We rejoice largely in our personal accomplishments, don't we? We rejoice in those things. We rejoice in our children's accomplishments. Just ask me, I'll tell you. We rejoice in, we rejoice in our recreation. We do. I don't think there's shame in any of those things. There are a lot of things we rejoice in, but he says rejoice in the Lord. Why? To have peace with God. Okay. To have peace with God, he says, let's go on here. He says, "Let your reasonableness be known." I think that many versions, and you tell me, say gentleness. To have peace with God, you have to have reasonableness. You have to have gentleness that is visible in your life. That people know that they can come to you and you're not going to respond to them with harsh words or criticism. Well, to have peace with God, he says, "Let your reasonableness or your gentleness be known to everyone. The Lord is at hand. Do not be anxious about anything." What are you anxious about? You know, there's a lot of things that we could be anxious about, okay? I'm not going to get off into the things that I'm anxious about. You don't need to tell me. We're all anxious about some things. But he says, do not be anxious for anything. So to have peace with God, one of the things that we've got to do is we've got to let go of our anxiety. And he tells us how to do that. "But in everything, by prayer and supplication with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God." If you're anxious about something, the way you deal with it is you pray about it. Do you? Now, I look around and I see a lot of male faces in here this morning. And I see some gray hair. Okay? So I know that you have had at least once in your life where you have woken up at 3 a.m. and couldn't go back to sleep. You may be going through that now. That's anxiety. Nikola Tesla believed that was the spirit, waking you up, because that's the time when you can be the most creative. That's Tesla's idea. Okay, not a bad idea, necessarily. But when you wake up at 2 a.m. or 3 a.m. and you can't get back to sleep and there's some anxiety on your heart, maybe you have to search to know what that is. Maybe you know what it is automatically. How do you deal with that? Prayer and supplication, Paul said. Pray yourself back to sleep. He says of the peace of God that it is a peace that passes all understanding. Because when you wake up at 3 a.m. and you can't get back to sleep and you pray yourself back to sleep, you don't know where that came from. Or you, at first you think, how did that happen? Because I've been going through this night after night after night for weeks on end. The peace of God that surpasses all understanding, a peace washes over you that you know where it's from, but you don't understand. And he says that will guard your heart. And he tells us a second way for us to deal with any of our anxieties, and that is to focus on something different. Focus on positive things. Now, here's a difference between Eastern and Western thought. If you know anything about Eastern religions, particularly Buddhism, the idea is to empty yourself of everything. Their idea of meditation is you just empty your mind. How a human being can empty their mind, I don't know. But that is the difference, because Paul is telling us here, when you pray and when you're going through supplications, daily works of service, you fill your mind with goodness. What goodness? He says, meditate on, think about, fill your mind with things that are true. I work in a university system. I came to work in higher ed because I believed in the pursuit of truth and beauty. I don't know that that's what academia is about anymore. But it's not. Where do you go to find truth? I love the internet. But to find truth on the internet, you've got to really search for it, don't you? And you've got to you got to know what it is before you get there. That's right. That's exactly right. But you have to parse through it. You have to search through it. You have to sift it, right? Some of it you'll accept, some of it you won't, and that's good. Okay, that's what a critical mind does. But finding truth, God's word is truth. As a matter of fact, if we get to know each other any better, one of the things that you're going to hear me constantly say, my agenda is to get people to read their Bibles. And this is what I tell them. I have read a lot of stuff. I have been forced to read things I didn't want to read. Okay? That's the nature of education. They put you through the paces and they cause you to read things that you wouldn't have read on your own. And I've read a lot of stuff. I read a lot of stuff I wanted to read. There was a period of my life where I was focused on personal development, and I read all, you know, I used to listen to Jim Rohn religiously. If any of you have ever heard of Jim, passed on, great motivational speaker. Some of you may have listened to Earl Nightingale, people like that. I used to love that stuff, eat it up. I have read a lot of stuff, but I'm telling you that of all the things I've ever read, and I learned to read in an ancient language once upon a time, and spent about 4 years reading New Testament Greek in its original form. And, of course, that was great. That was an enriching experience. And I still use some of those tools and those skills today in Bible study. But I have never read anything that has compelled me more, truthfully, than the Bible. And so of all the things that you could read, I hope that you're reading your Bible. I hope that you're spending some time in the Bible, because that is the ultimate truth, if you're interested in the truth. But he goes on to say that, you know, you need to focus on things. You need to think about things that are true. You need to think about things that are noble, things that are just. Where is justice in our society? Think about things that are pure, the things that are lovely. I mean, I could go on and on and on about these things, talking about them very deeply. Things that are of good report. I love to hear good news, don't you? I love to turn on the television. I don't love to turn on the television, but when I turn on the television and I watch the news, I don't watch much news. I read most of my news, and I really don't read that much news. I read a lot of headlines. I'm one of those people that people in the news don't like because I'm just reading the headlines. If it doesn't strike me, I don't read it. That's the way most people do now, okay? I love to find a good story about something good. Good reports. If there is anything that is virtuous or praiseworthy, these are the kinds of things that we've got to learn to fill our minds with, and we will have that peace that passes all understanding that will guard our hearts. Paul's request for the Philippians, he goes on here. He says, what verse is it? Finally, my brethren, he already said that. Verse 9 is what I'm looking for. What you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, practice these things, and the God of peace will be with you. So, these folks did not have a complete New Testament like we do. They had the letter to the Philippians. I don't know what other letters they had. So, what did they have to go by to know how to live a Christian life besides that? They probably had some of the Gospels. They had examples. They had the example of Paul. Who is your example of living a Christian life? I hope that your example of someone who's living the Christian life is in this audience this morning or is a member of this congregation. It is a legitimate thing for us to follow the faith of others, to look to have human examples of people who are have a good prayer life, who read their Bibles, who are doing works of service, doing works of ministry, that someone that you identify with and you want to imitate their faith. That's what Paul says. He says, imitate my faith. He says that over and over. Because since they didn't have a Bible to read on their own, they needed human examples. And what better example than that of an apostle? A third kind of peace that was better than what Rome could offer was having peace with your circumstances. And I get that from verses 10 through 19. I'm not going to read that. I think I've got about 10 minutes left. So it was peace with our circumstances. Now, I don't need you to tell me what your circumstances are. It's not that I'm callous, that I don't care. It's not that at all. It's just that we're limited on time, aren't we? Okay. So I'm going to look at some circumstances that we would be familiar with. One of the things that he says here is, we'll pick this out here. This is a passage that you know well. Verse 13, I can do all things through him who strengthens me. Before that, he told him, he said, I have learned in my life, and I'm paraphrasing, I have learned how to be poor. I have learned how to be wealthy. And I can be happy in either circumstance. Years ago, when I was at the Woodstock Church in Woodstock, Georgia, we had a day school, and one of the teachers in the day school, fine lady, Delta was going. Her husband was a Delta pilot, and Delta was going through one of their, you know, it must have been around 2007, 2008. They were going through a downturn. They were about to lay pilots off, and I remember her saying, that her husband may have been furloughed, may have gotten furloughed or may get furloughed, and they were worried about what their circumstances were going to be. And she said, you know what? She said, I was worried about it. And she said, then I just decided I grew up poor. I know how to be poor. We can do this again, and he'll get another job, and it'll be fine. And that's exactly what I thought about was Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. I've learned how to do. You've had various circumstances in your life. You have had times where you were on highs and times when you were lows. You've learned how to get through. That gray hair that I talked about a minute ago, that is proof that you've learned how to survive. You've learned how to deal with your circumstances, whatever they are. What are some other circumstances? Well, when it comes to having and doing and being, we live in a culture that has taught us from a very early age, don't ever settle for anything less than the best, right? So it's a little difficult to talk about, even in audiences like this, about, you know, learning to do all things through him who strengthens me. We can say those words, but we're living in a culture that teaches us and conditions us to something very different, okay? But now, when people encourage you not to settle for less than the best, who are those people and what were their circumstances? You ever thought about that? You know, growing up, I wanted to be a pilot. But I wore glasses, and so people told me all the time, you can't be a pilot. You don't have good vision. You know? And I used to, you know, I might come up with some other thing that I wanted to do, and somebody would come along and say, well, you can't do that because of this, you know. You can't always listen to everything that people tell you because some people are just good at squashing your dreams, right? Not that I was ever going to be I wanted to be a fighter pilot, and so they were probably right. I wasn't going to make it in that. But anyway, you get what I'm pointing at, and that is that someone else's idea of the best for you may not fit you, okay? It wouldn't suit you. You know, if you grow up in a household where your dad was a doctor and your mother was a lawyer and they want your dad wants you to go to medical school and your mother wants you to go to law school, but you wind up driving a truck. Nothing wrong with driving a truck. Matter of fact, you look at the salaries they make today, pretty good living, isn't it? Okay, if you like that kind of thing, there's nothing wrong with that. But yet, people in the family may go, well, you know, we're disappointed in you because you didn't become a doctor, you didn't become a lawyer, you didn't do this, you didn't do that. And it could be any other thing. You know, you didn't go out and start your own business and build it to, you know, billions of dollars. Everybody's disappointed in you. What everybody tells you, don't settle for less than the best. You can't always listen to that. You've got to follow your heart and do what's right for you. Okay? On that same idea with your circumstances, if you are in the circumstance where you've got a high-pressure job with a high salary, or maybe you have a high-pressure job with a low salary, or maybe you have no job at all, it's kind of hard to be at peace when you're in circumstances like that, isn't it? But what he's telling us here is if you want to have peace in your life, he says you've got to have peace with your circumstances. These early Christians, they would have been likely very poor, many of them. Okay? And he's telling them that you can have peace and you don't have to look down on yourself. Another circumstance, you know, well, this idea of high salary, low salary, whatever the salary, a job that meets your needs with a little left over and time enough to balance your life and enjoy it and raise your family, that can be rewarding. You don't have to wear a title. You don't have to, you know, have all these great accomplishments in your life. That's a circumstance that you can still be at peace with. When it comes to education, you know, as an educator, I try to encourage people to get as much education as they can get, as much as you can get intellectually, as much as you can get financially, but that's different for everybody. Don't, you know, be at peace with your circumstance if you get to go to a PhD, okay? Be satisfied with your circumstance if you get to be an apprentice, plumber, or electrician, okay? Be at peace with your circumstance. When it comes, some circumstances, another circumstance, people find themselves unmarried. And, you know, the Bible says that in 1 Corinthians, Paul wrote that singles have a place of value in the church and in the kingdom. There's no law that states that you have to get married and you have to have children. Some people find themselves in a circumstance where they're unmarried and have no children. There's a place for you in the kingdom. Another circumstance that we look at broadly is churches themselves think in their circumstance that, you know, we're just too small. We can't do big things. Well, the brotherhood is filled with small churches that do great things. The size of a congregation has nothing to do with its value, its place in the kingdom, or as to whether there is peace or not in that congregation. I have worked with a little congregation for the last 7 years that 2 weeks ago, we had 91 people present. Last week, we had 47, you know. But you know what we've got? Superstition coming out. We've got peace. We've got peace. If you want peace in your life, when we read this, how do you get it? You have to pursue it. I really think that's the overall message. The peace that passes all understanding is the peace is the peace of God, and it is only found in Jesus Christ. Are there any questions? Any additional comments? Well, the first bell has rung. And that's all I have for you this morning. I appreciate the opportunity to speak to you this morning. I hope that you found something of value in it. I'll stop now. Pardon? It's in the Lord. In the Lord, absolutely. Absolutely. Thank you very much. Yes, sir. Absolutely. There you go. Yeah. And don't ever stop praying. Yeah.
I will call upon the Lord. Hey, he's worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord, who is worthy to be praised. So shall I be saved from my enemies. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. The Lord liveth, and blessed be the rock, and let the God of my salvation be exalted. I will call upon the Lord.
Gulf Shores Church of Christ, glad to have everybody out here today. First order of business, a pair of sunglasses. I'm going to assume women's sunglasses in the parking lot. Oh, I know who they are. Got it. All right, that was easy. Where's my button? First order of business is, like I said, welcome to everybody, Gulf Shores Church of Christ. Welcome to visitors and the members alike. Glad to have all of y'all with us today. If you've got your phones, first thing we want to do is silence your phone. But for the members on Alexio, be sure to log in on Alexio. Let us know you're here. And if you're a visitor, we would love to know about you. There is a QR code in the bulletin. You can put on that, and you can get on that QR code and give us your name and address and everything. And we also have books at the entrances, and we get those names down, and we send you out cards and invite you back anytime you're in town. And I say every weekend, if you're new to the area, looking for a church, you have found it. As far as the announcements go this morning, Senior and Snowbird Luncheon will be on April 18th at noon at Bolo Steak and Seafood in Orange Beach. Please sign up on the sign-up sheet in the bulletin board next to the fishbowl. That's over there. Today at 5 p.m. at Michael and Deborah Hudson's house, there will be a youth devotional. Be sure to attend that. PBS meeting has been moved to April 21st, immediately after the service in the conference room. And also on the 21st, there's an area-wide devotional at Margaret Street Church of Christ. They're going to leave here at 1:45. As far as prayer requests this morning, Harriet Lang is still in rehab in Huntsville with her daughter. Continued prayers. Keith Hall is here today. He's recovering from knee surgery. He's doing much better. John and Patricia Galloway are having health issues. I got a note here about a young man named Jackson May. He's 18 years old. He went out to California, got sick out there, basically ended up with open heart surgery. 18-year-old. Some of the kids may know him. He was an Orange Beach football player. Be sure to keep him in your prayers. Also, Don's not here with us this morning. Don Tassin, he's still battling his issues with cancer. Dad Snyder is still battling their issues. One last thing to keep on your list, Roger and Charlene are heading to Michigan. I believe they're heading to Michigan tomorrow. Keep them in prayer. They're traveling from here up to there. Has done that before. It's not very much fun. Any other announcements, prayer requests this morning? Yes, ma'am. That's right. Today's Harriet's birthday. Harriet, yes. And
we all hope she's doing a lot better. Maybe someday you two can get back. All right, that's all. I'll go to our Father in prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for this day, this wonderful day you've given us. Thank you for this wonderful church, the members we have here, and the guests that we have every weekend. Lord, we live in a blessed area of the country, and we are so blessed. Lord, there's people that we spoke about this morning that need your help, Lord. We pray that we can do all the things that we can do for them, but Lord, we know that you have the final say on things, and Lord, we send you our prayers that they be restored to their health. Lord, again, we thank you for the great blessings that we have. We thank you for this wonderful area. Lord, we hope that today that we'll pay attention to the speaker, we'll learn from the lesson, and we'll use it to improve our lives. Lord, the greatest blessing of all is, though, is the blessing of your Son, Jesus, who you sent to this earth to die for our sins. Lord, may we never forget that. When our time on this earth comes to an end, we pray, Lord, that we have done as you ask, and you'll give us home with you in heaven. In Christ we pray. Amen. Please stand for the reading. Psalms 130, 5 through 8, New King James Version. I will wait for the Lord. My soul waits. And in his word I do hope. My soul waits for the Lord more than those who watch for the morning. Yes, more than those who watch for the morning. O Israel, hope in the Lord. For with the Lord there is mercy. And with him is abundant redemption. He shall redeem Israel from all his iniquity. May the Lord bless the reading. Please remain standing because we have a standing song.
I thought it was a good idea yesterday before I led singing to cut grass for some reason. If I quit and cough, you keep singing.
Are you not filled with the Spirit now? Say amen. We started this morning with Brian Collins and his wife Samia. Brian was in here preaching to the men's class, and Samia was talking to the ladies. And I apologize, ladies. We did not give you all the best seat in the house. It's horrible to sit in those chairs for that long, but I'm sure you were lifted by the Spirit with her talk. Today we are also welcoming Brian. He is going to be a preacher candidate. He comes to us from Huntsville, Alabama. Please give him your attention.
Thank you, Brother Wayne. Good morning. It is good to see everybody here. Glad that you're out. And if you came in and you were dragging in, you're not dragging anymore, are you? Singing was fantastic. I appreciate Brother Nathan for his ability to get us going this morning. If you've got a Bible with you this morning, I'd like for you to join me in Luke chapter 11. We're going to talk about just a few verses there. Luke 11 is a very important chapter. It's an interesting chapter because the way it opens, you know, you think about these guys who have followed Jesus for this long, and they've heard Jesus preach, they've watched Jesus perform miracles, and of all the things that they witnessed and learned from Jesus, they said, Lord, teach us to pray. Isn't that beautiful? Because the one thing that they wanted to do more than anything, if I were there then, I would have said, Lord, teach me to teach in parables like you do. Lord, teach me to preach like you do. But they said, Lord, teach us to pray. Because that was the one thing they felt like, among all the other things that they could, that is the one thing that they really wanted to emulate about Jesus. They wanted to have a prayer life like Jesus. Now, I want you to use your imagination for just a minute. Actually, I want you to use your memory. I want you to go back, and I want you to think about this. It hasn't been that long ago that they were planning a wedding in England. I know you know which one I'm talking about, unless you've been under a rock for the past few years. You know, William and Kate were getting married. Don't ask me what year that was. I don't even remember. But I know you know. Now, here's the question, and do not raise your hand. I am not asking for a show of hands. How many of you were expecting an invitation in the mail? I judge from the laughter that not any of us. Now, I realize that some of you may be connected. I have no idea who's in this audience. Maybe you are connected to the royal family. But what I'm suggesting to you is not to say that you weren't worthy of an invitation. My suggestion is like me, you didn't have the access. That's what we're talking about today. We're talking about access. You know, I know that many of you probably in the early 80s, you watched William's mother and father get married, Charles, who's now the king, and then Diana. And then you probably watched at least some of it. I have to admit, I watched some of it. I can't watch a whole thing. You know, I have things to do, and I know that many of you do too, but I saw a little bit of it. But, you know, none of us attended the wedding because we don't have access. As a matter of fact, I don't know what has to take place. I don't understand the protocols for what it is to get in front of a king, to be able to shake the hand of a president, because I don't have the access. I have never met a royal. I've never met a president. I've never had the pleasure of shaking a president's hand, and I probably never will. As a matter of fact, I'm not so sure I want to. I don't know that I want to have an audience with the king. All of that is just outside of my realm of experience and probably will always be. A few years ago, when I lived in Georgia, I had the audacity to write a letter to my congressman. And I got back a few weeks later a response that had a printed signature on it. And in the letter, they told me that they would convey my concerns to the proper authorities. And I thought, all right, I'm in. When I was, and by the way, thank you for receiving my wife and showing her your attention in class. I know that some of you have already told me what a great job she did. You didn't have to tell me. I knew she'd do a fantastic job. She has a great story. But she is an American citizen. But she is a naturalized American citizen. She and I walked together through the process of immigration on our own. And I can tell you, when we married, we were in Pakistan, and I had to leave her there for 10 months and come back and file her paperwork. And there were so many people around me who rallied around me and were going to touch all of their access points to get that process sped up. And what we saw was, we saw that what I learned was, what people think is access really isn't. And I'm not blaming them. They wanted to help. They tried to help, but they couldn't help because their access, even in their own minds, was an illusion. But before I sound like I'm, you know, bitter about it, and I'm not. It's one of those things that happened. It was God's will. I just say this to illustrate a point, a spiritual point. And that is, while you and I, we may lack the access to attend a royal wedding, to shake the hand of a president, or to be able to convince our local senator to do something that is in everybody's best interest, we just don't have the access. And though you may not have the access to these powerful individuals, have you ever considered the access that you have to the most powerful individual in existence? Have you ever thought much about that? Have you ever considered the fact that you can, at your will and your whim and your convenience, that you can speak to the Most High God? You ever thought about that and how important that is? I asked you a minute ago to open your Bibles to Luke chapter 11. I want you to look down. We talked about verse 1. I want you to look down at verses 9 and 10 and look at what it says there. And I'll tell you, this is Jesus talking, ask and it'll be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and it'll be opened to you. For everyone who asks receives, and to the one who seeks finds, and to the one who knocks, it'll be open. Beautiful words there, aren't they? That all you have to do is ask, and he is ready to assist you. And he is willing to assist you. But more than that, you have open access, day or night, anytime, through prayer, God. And let me tell you, this is no small thing. You know, I made kind of a joke about royal weddings and meeting presidents because I know what it is to lack this access. We all lack this access to powerful people, but we lack no access to the one who can really get it done in our favor, Jesus Christ and the Almighty God. So I want us to spend just a very few minutes this morning thinking about the implications that access has for all of us. The first thing that it implies is that you, through your prayer life, yes, you, however significant or insignificant you may feel, you have open access anytime, day or night, to the Creator of the world. You talk about power. When we open the Bible to open our Bibles to Genesis chapter 1. What are the very first words that it says there? In the beginning, when there was a beginning, when all this got started, in the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And we know that he spoke them into existence. In other words, everything that we can see, when you go down to the beach later today and you look out 180 degrees at that horizon and you think about, I think the earth curves every 6 or 7 miles, although you can't necessarily take in that curve in that 180 degrees, but you may see a ship sailing out there where the sea and the sky meet, and you think about how far out that is. That's 6, 7 miles, maybe more, that you can see out into the vastness of the ocean. And realize that the God you pray to created that with the sound of his voice. That's pretty amazing. That's pretty awe-inspiring when you think about it. And then you go over to John chapter 1, the Gospel of John, the very first words that he says, what does he say? He says, in the beginning was the Word. And Word is capitalized there, the divine logos. He was in the beginning with God. And he even tells us that not one thing came into being that has come into being
apart from him. In other words, he was there creating it. Who was the Word? Jesus Christ. In the beginning with God. And then you turn back over to Genesis, the second chapter of Genesis. Genesis chapter 2, the seventh verse tells us that the Almighty God created man from the dust of the earth. You know what I imagine? I imagine God reaching down there with his hands into that dirt that he made. I don't know too many people that can make dirt. He reached down there, and I think about the potter and the clay. He formed the man from the dust of the earth, and it says, he blew on him. He breathed into his nostrils the breath of life, and he became a living being. That's power to make you and I come to life. So when you consider that raw power for God, to the creator of the world, to speak the world into existence, who cares what kind of access you have to royals and politicians? Because of the access that you have to the Almighty God. What could you accomplish in your life organizing your entire life around that one idea? What could the church accomplish if we organized ourselves around the idea of the access that we have to the creator of the world? Second implication that this verse has for us is that you and I, no matter how significant or insignificant we feel, we have, through prayer, access to the King of Kings. Lord of Lords. As I said before, I told you, I don't understand the protocol. I don't understand what it is to appear before a royal or a politician. And let me tell you, we can learn from our Bibles that it's not exactly an open door, if we didn't already know that, right? We could learn from our Bibles that when it comes to royal families, it is not an open door. The ladies were studying Esther this morning. Now, I want you ladies to think about this. In Esther chapter 4, verse 11, we're introduced to the idea that Esther, as the queen, does not have open access to her husband. You mean to tell me that I can't just open my husband's office door? I can't just go down to my husband's office and walk in and say, "Hey, hon, how you doing? How's the day going?" She didn't have that kind of access. Esther chapter 4, verse 11. As a matter of fact, it tells us there that anyone who came into the king's chambers, there was a man there that was ready to take the life of anybody who dared to open that door unless they had been called. And even then, if they busted into the door and got in the door and didn't get killed, he had to lay out his scepter to them to stop that man who was going to take the life. And so Esther was really worried about using that favor to access her own husband. And then we read about Nehemiah. I think it's about the second chapter that Nehemiah was the king's cupbearer. And when he found out the condition that Jerusalem was in, that the walls were broken down and the gates were burned with fire, that he was sad and he cried and he had to go into the presence of the king. And, you know, he didn't have time to wash his face and he was worried about what he was going to look like because the king had the power to dismiss him or dispatch him. And he was worried about it. He could not appear sad in the presence of the king. You ever been around? You know how, as a boss, those of you that are bosses, do you realize the influence that you have on your employees? If you come in scowling and fussing, everybody else is going to scowl and fuss the rest of the day. But if you come in and you welcome everybody with a good morning and you've got a smile on your face, just think about how well that day goes. It was that way with the king. It wasn't just an open door. If you were sad, you're going to make the king sad. And the king didn't want to be sad. What did he have to be sad about? You remember the prophet Nathan. He took his own life into his hands when he dared to confront David with his sin with Bathsheba. We know that David himself was worried. Not only was he running from King Saul, he was worried about what it was going to be like when he wasn't in his proper place at the king's table. What's the king going to do? See, there's no such thing as a casual relationship. Just because you don't have access, you might not want access. But you've got access to the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. But you know, because we lack experience and knowledge, with this sort of access, I think maybe we don't appreciate the kind of access that we've been granted from the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. Just like we read a minute ago in Luke chapter 11, verses 9 and 10. Matthew chapter 7, verse 7 says the same thing. Ask and it'll be given to you. Seek and you'll find. Knock and it'll be opened to you. In chapter 7, verse 11, Jesus goes on to say, if you, being a parent, you being evil at that, as a parent, know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Father in heaven give to you who ask? Boy, isn't that a good illustration? Coming straight from the mouth of the Creator. If you are a parent and you want to give your children the best and you are willing to make any sacrifice to give to the best you can give to your children, how much more will God give? You know, if your child comes to you and says, Dad, I'm hungry, you're going to feed that kid. Dad, I want to go to college. You're going to make sure that kid goes to college, right? You're going to do everything in your power to give your children the best that you can give them. And Jesus says, if that's the way you are, what do you think about God when his children ask him for the very best things? Mark chapter 11, verse 24 says, therefore I say to you, whatever things you ask when you pray, believe that you will receive them and you will have them. I think James adds the caveat, when you pray, you better pray believing. Because somebody that doesn't believe they're going to receive it. It's like a man tossed on the waves, the ocean. But this is the same idea. It just comes through repeated throughout Scripture more times than I have to survey in this lesson. So what I want to say to you on this is that your King has not only welcomed you with open arms into his throne room, he has commanded you to come there anytime, and when you come there, you better pour out your heart to him, whether you feel sad, whether you're crying, whether you're happy, and you're grateful. Pour out your heart to him. I want to share another beautiful passage in this vein from Hebrews chapter 4. Hebrews chapter 4, verses 14 through 16. So since then we have such a great high priest who has passed through the heavens, Jesus the Son of God, let us hold fast our confession. For we do not have a high priest who is unable to sympathize with our weaknesses, but one who is in every respect has been tempted as we are, yet without sin. Let us then, here's the operant verse, let us then with confidence draw near to the throne of grace that we may receive mercy and find grace in time of need. That's where I get this idea that we've been commanded to come into the throne room of God. And when we get there, we open our mouths and our hearts and we tell him everything. We just pour it out right there in front of the throne of grace. That gives us new ideas about that, doesn't it? But you know what? There is a protocol when we come before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. When you consider the fact that we are praying before the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, would you not, the Almighty God, would you not bow your head? Would you not bend your knee in prayer? You know, Isaiah, when he received his call, Isaiah 6, 1 through 4, one of the things that he said was, woe is me, I'm undone, for I'm a man of unclean lips. He had to go in front of the king. He appeared before the king in the throne room. He saw the king on the throne high and lifted up and was worried. That tells us that we need to bow and bend the knee. When we consider what we have in this avenue of prayer, how could it not fill us with gratitude? To come before the Lord with gratitude, we suddenly realizing all the blessings of the things that maybe even we take for granted. You say, well, what did I take for granted this morning? Maybe the fact that you woke up. Maybe the fact that you were able to see, hear, smell, taste, touch. What's that worth? What is it worth to you to be able to kick your feet out of bed and stand up on the balls of your feet and walk? What's that worth? Take it for granted all the time. What does it mean to have food and clothes and shelter? And not just food and clothes and shelter. I bet many of you woke up this morning with the air conditioner on. Or if you were cold, the heat was on. And you probably got into the shower and had hot water. In other words, you have a fine shelter. And you didn't put on just some clothes. Everybody here is dressed real well. You're wearing nice clothes. You probably had, if you ate something this morning, it was because you wanted to eat. If you didn't eat, it was because you didn't want to eat. And you probably fared sumptuously this morning. What does it mean to you to be able to pay your bill? You know, this understanding is the kind of thing that fills us with hope and vigor, that we have the hope, that we have the access to the one who saves, to the one who has been involved in world affairs since the beginning. I love the passage in Ecclesiastes chapter 3 that says he has made everything beautiful in its time. I can't quote it. But he says that he has put eternity in the hearts of mankind, except that we can't know what God does from beginning to end. But one of the things that I know that he does is it's his job to make the rise and the fall of the nations. Everything that we know about history was in his power. What's going on right now in the world that we may or may not like what's going on, it's him behind the scenes. Even though we may not understand why or wherefore. When it comes to that protocol, I said a minute ago, how could you not bow your head? How could you not thank? How could you not plead? That's the protocol. That really gives new meaning to grace and mercy, does it not? How could we not but bow our heads when we come into the throne room of God and bend our knee and plead with God, show him gratitude? But there's a third implication that I want to share with you this morning, and that is that you and I, as simple and, you know, in the eyes of God, we're pretty small. Really a speck in time. But yet through prayer, you and I, as significant or as insignificant as we feel, we have access to and involvement in the only kingdom that will never fail. You know, I've always liked to think of myself as a patriot. And I'm not that old, but I can remember a time that was very different. As a matter of fact, the world my children, the country that my children have grown up in is not the country that I grew up in, unfortunately. The things that are happening today, if you had asked me 20 years ago, I'd say, no, there's no way that could happen in the United States of America, but yet I've been proven wrong. You know, there are some of us that are looking at our country right now and we're scared, we're worried that our country's going to fail. But we don't need to be afraid because we have access to the Creator of the world and the Lord, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we are part of a kingdom that's far more important than the country of the United States that is also just a speck in time. Because we serve that Creator God, that King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and we have been given access to and involvement in the only kingdom that will never fail. Now, this may sound silly to you, but the kingdom of God, wherever you feel about sovereign borders, it has open borders. You know how I know that? Because the Bible tells me that everyone, everywhere, regardless of their background, regardless of their past, regardless of their race or their gender, has an opportunity to come into the kingdom of God. You don't have to fill out any paperwork. I'm not trying to be silly here. This is serious. You have been invited to become a part of a kingdom that embraces all nations and tongues. He not only understands the languages those other people throughout the world speak, he created those languages. They can talk to him and he will understand them. It doesn't matter what color they are. The only thing that matters is whether or not they obey. That's the only condition. You have to obey. And when you're judged on the basis of your heart. As I said, there's no paperwork, there's no hassle, there's no fees to pay. Just obedience. The kingdom of God will never be overthrown. Consider that. 2 Peter chapter 1, verses 9, 10 and 11 says, therefore, brethren, be even more diligent to make your call and election sure. For if you do these things, you will never stumble. For so an entrance will be supplied to you abundantly into the everlasting kingdom of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Think about that. The kingdom of heaven will never fail. It will never go broke. It'll never rob a pension plan. It will never run a deficit. It will never create an unfunded mandate. There will not be a recession. There will not be a depression ever. And more on top of that, Jesus said in John chapter 14, verses 2 and 3, he said he was going to prepare a place for you. I want to live in a house that's built by Jesus, don't you? And that's what he's saying there. I've got a dwelling place for you, and guess what? No bubble markets. Again, I'm not trying to be silly here. We worry about our property. You don't have to worry about the property, the house that Jesus is building for you. God's kingdom cannot be overthrown from the inside or the outside. Another passage I want to share with you, and this will be the last one, Hebrews chapter 12. I'm not going to read all these. It starts in 25, but if you look there at verse 29, my eyes aren't falling on it. Verse 28, actually. Therefore, let us be grateful for receiving a kingdom that cannot be shaken. And thus let us offer to God acceptable worship with reverence and awe, for our God is a consuming fire. You know, my hope for this, to show you these three implications of serving the God, having access to the Creator God, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and access to and involvement in the only kingdom that is never going to fail, is that it will renew your appreciation for your dependence upon prayer, and that you will devote yourself as a Christian to the one thing that you can do to imitate Jesus, and that is to have a prayer life like Jesus. You may never ever preach a sermon. You may never be able to tell a parable. You may not ever. I would love to learn how to formulate those things like Jesus did, but I'll never be able to do it. But the one thing that I can do is I can pray like Jesus. The Gospel of Luke shows that everything major that happened in the life of Jesus was met with prayer. That's the way you can handle your life. Every major event in your life should be met with prayer, because you have open access day or night to the Creator of the world, who spoke the world into existence, the King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and you are part of a kingdom that cannot be shaken. This morning, I want you to think about these verses. Paul told the Thessalonians in 1 Thessalonians chapter 5, verse 17, to pray without ceasing. Does that mean you have to die with a prayer on your lips? I don't believe so. It just means that all through the day, your dependence must be upon God, and therefore you're talking to God all day long at various parts of the day. He told Timothy in 1 Timothy chapter 2, verse 8, I desire, therefore, that men pray everywhere, lifting up holy hands without wrath and doubting. James, as I mentioned a minute ago, he wrote that we ought to pray when we're suffering, James chapter 5, verse 13, and that the prayers of a righteous man avail much. They're powerful, James 5, 18. And then finally, Peter wrote in 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7, but the end of all things is at hand. Therefore, be serious and watchful in your prayers. This morning, do you have a prayer life like Jesus? It can be yours. Are you a member of that kingdom that cannot be shaken? That too can be yours. Whatever your need this morning, we invite you to come as we stand and sing this hymn of invitation.
Blood, for shame, for me.
our next song this morning to help prepare our minds to take the Lord's Supper.
Your hand, some will be brought to you. Although we call this the Lord's Supper, it is not a meal. It is a memorial. It is not to be partaken without reverent regard for what it represents. We are told to do this. All of us are told to do this. We are told what to do, and we are told who to remember. Jesus and his sacrifice for each and every one of us. This is to be done each and every time we come together. According to 1 Corinthians 11:26, every time that we do this, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he comes. It entails the use of tangible specific elements, the bread and the fruit of the vine. It is a personal remembrance. We are to remember Jesus. Our focus is to be on none other. It is a form of confession. In partaking in this properly, We are declaring that Jesus gave his body and his blood for me. It is a self-examination. Let each one of us examine ourselves, as Scripture tells us, to take of this memorial in a worthy manner. Let us pray. Most gracious and loving Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the sacrifice you made. As that song we just sang, you arose, death could not hold you. We're so thankful that you are willing to make that sacrifice for us. We pray that each and every one will examine their hearts and they will do this in your memory, thinking of you. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Jesus also shed his blood on that cross, the blood that we come in contact with when we are baptized into his death that cleanses us of our sins. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, we're so thankful for the shedding of that blood, that cleansing blood that once and forever atoned for our sins. Thankful for your Son, Jesus Christ, and your willingness to send him to this earth and his willingness to die on that cross for each and every one of us. So thankful, Lord. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Morning that each one of us was dressed nicely and we had good food to eat this morning. We are all blessed beyond what we deserve. Get this opportunity to give back. As you can see on the screen, there are many ways that you can donate. There are baskets at each of the entrances that you can go to Alexio. You can send it in the mail. The key here is to give generously with a cheerful heart, and we all need to do that. Let's pray for that offering. Loving Heavenly Father, we're so thankful. Thankful that people give for the furtherment of your church here on earth. We pray for the use of these funds, the elders, they oversee them. Pray that they will be used in the right way. More people will hear the gospel, and more people will be able to know that you are the one true and only God. Thank you for the opportunities you give us. Thank you for the blessings, Lord, and we pray that our giving will be done with your blessing and in a proper manner. Thank you for Jesus. In his name we pray. Amen.
Appreciate all of you being here with us today for visiting. Please stick around. Let us get to know you. You are not alone. In fact, you are the majority. So stick around and let us get to know you. And we look forward to having you back at any and every opportunity. Is there anything else? Did I get up in front of somebody? Is there supposed to be an announcement? Okay. Let's stand together and we'll be dismissed and closed.
Father, we just thank you so much for the time that we can be here, to be renewed, to have peace, and to have love shown among us, Father, from the things we see day to day, as our brother Collins has mentioned this morning. This world is not the one that I grew up in, and it's changing in ways that I wish it wouldn't. But we know that when we come to a congregation of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, when we're here at worship, we see things that, and we experience things that's filled with love, sincerity, and people are honest with their feelings. And we just thank you for this renewing we've had this morning, not only with our members here, but also with our visitors, and especially with Brother and Sister Collins this morning, who have shared their time and their talents and their love with us. We ask and pray you bless them as they go forward, wherever they're traveling. We pray that you'll be with our visitors as they remain here, maybe visiting with us this week. Care for them, help them as they go back home. Father, there's people that are suffering right now. There's people among our blood families. There's people among our family in Jesus who are suffering. And Father, there's all we can do is just beg and plead and petition you to heal them. And we just ask and pray your will would be that, Father, to heal these people who we're praying so fervently for. We thank you so much for your love. We thank you so much for your mercy and grace. And we're thankful so much for Jesus, who makes it possible, Father, that once we leave this earth, we have a hope to be with you someday in eternity. It's in your Son's name I pray. Amen.